All right, this is going to be the final section or the final video of summing up the things. The only thing that's remaining is the UI part. Let's make a little bit decent stuff. And what's going to be helping us is really the UI part of it. So we are using DAISY UI, and I'll walk you through some of the concepts of it. We'll have a discussion so that you can use more of its component in the future videos, and we'll go through with that. Most of the code I'll be just showing you. This is going to be a walkthrough because it's just a UI part. I don't want to waste your time in just writing the Tailwind CSS and the classes and bringing that, hey, this opens the drawer, this closes the drawer. No, I don't want to do that. But I'll walk you through with the part of it. So first of all, I'll walk you through that, hey, I have added inside this app folder a new file, which is layout. This is a standard practice when you want to lay out all the pages. So every single page like home, social share, video upload, all of them are going to be inside the layout. This is how the layout works. If you check out the outside layout, this is how it looks. So the whole job of the layout is something like this. You call it as a root layout. Then you accept the children. That means any inside page comes into this and we'll just wrap it up. So when we wrap it up with the clerk provider or this HTML body, the whole thing is actually wrapped up. And this is where you mention the children part of it. So that's really the basic of it. Similarly, we have added this layout, and before I talk about the layout, I'll walk you through with the DAISY UI, and yeah, by the way, this is how it looks like. Notice it. It's really, really nice now. So first of all, let's go into DAISY UI, and the reason for using the DAISY UI is the components of it. It's really nice that how things actually work. So we have artboard, avatar, we have so much of the breadcrumbs and chat bubbles and so much of going on. The one that we are using is the drawer here. I hope you can see that. Yep, that's visible. And this is how the drawer looks like. So the drawer is really nice. You can actually open it up on some incidents as well, like a click or maybe some actions like shrinking of the browser. A lot of things can happen, or you can just keep it as responsive and state up here. So if I go ahead and shrink it down, notice here it automatically goes away. So this is the one that we are using. If you go ahead and check it out on our website as well, this is exactly the one that we are using. So it is just goes like that. And we are doing nothing in it. We are doing nothing. It's all up here. So you can go ahead and check up their HTML or JSX. That is always a good idea. So inside the JSX, they goes up for the open drawer. So anything that opens up the drawer and on the large screen, it's hidden and all of that, not on the large screen, it's hidden. yeah, it's as soon as we hit the large breakpoint, it gets hit. So they follow all the convention of the Tailwind CSS. So this is what we are using exactly. Now let me walk you through with the code part of it. So a couple of things that we are going with that. Some of the icons from the Lucid icon. The interesting part is we are using the clerk as well as use user, which is a hook that will tell us some more information. This is not same as auth. Auth just checks that whether a user is logged in or not. When you use user, then you can extract some more information like email address and whatnot. A lot of information can be extracted from it. So here we have mentioned all the sidebar items, which is home, social share, and video. So we'll be just looping through it wherever it is required. We're keeping off an eye on the sidebar open. And apart from this, we have brought in sign out from the clerk. And we have also brought in the user from the use user hook that I just mentioned. And after that, we have this logo click, which pushes you and handle sign out, which just await sign out, simple step. Now here, if you go ahead and look at the very little bit at the bottom side, this is again the code, which is interesting. So we are saying that whenever there is a user, we want to load this piece of component. And this component, what it does, it loads an image component here. In the image, we are using this user. I highly recommend you to do a console log on the user. It has so much more information. And we are checking whether there's an image URL. And in the alt part, we are actually saying, hey, go ahead and use username or the user email address. And similarly, we can extract the email address and more stuff. In the logout icon, we are doing nothing much, just handling the sign out, and that's it. You can see it's nothing much up there. Apart from this, there are a couple of sidebar. This is just a loop part. It's not even a backend code. It's just a front end. We are looping through the sidebar items and just linking them up. That's it. Nothing much. So this is the basics that we have gone through. And this actually leads to this kind of a page. So yeah, there we go. And again, this is not really the page you should be building up. You should be building your own pages, your own design. Maybe you want everything on the top bar. That makes sense. Maybe a drop-down menu. That makes sense. Whatever makes sense to you, go with that. So this is the whole application. And now what's missing is, or what I would not call missing, but what's remaining is the home page here. In the home page, we are not doing much. So let's go ahead and walk through. The UI part, I'll load it because we have the video component as it is, but I'll just make it a decent stuff and we are going to be working on it together. So this is what we have. And since we'll be using use state and stuff, it is nice that we make it first of all as use client. So that's a client page. There we go. Now, apart from the React, obviously we're going to be using use state. So use state. We'll be needing a use effect and callbacks as well. Use effect, and we'll be saying use callback. Use callback. Apart from this, Axios to make the request. Since we have Axios, I would not like to use, in fact, I would prefer to use React Query, but that's another tutorial for some another day. We'll be going Axios, and that will come from Axios. Let's also import the video card. Yep, that's there, video card. And what else we need? I think that's all what we need. We can also have the types. We don't have the types being defined for how the video will look like. We'll worry about it later on, but this is all what we need. Now, once we are here, we would love to see that whether we have an access to videos, or because what we'll be doing is we'll be making a request to the Prisma that, hey, just get me a query, and not to the Prisma actually. We are hitting our own APIs, and that will eventually call to the Prisma to get me the API, to get me the videos, and then I'll be just displaying that. To display that, I have to store that in the state, and that's it. That is all the plan. So let's just go ahead and say, hey, these are my videos, and this will be set videos, just like this. It's going to be an array of video, but we haven't yet defined it. Probably I'll define it in a minute, but this is fine. This is fine. This is going to be an empty array as of now, but we'll be loading up the information in it. And apart from this, we'll be needing a state for loading. So let's just go ahead and say loading. Set loading is going to be true. Right now it's loading. As soon as the page comes up, it will be loading, and after that we'll be turning it off. And let's also have one of the state for error and set error. Right now there is no error. Or we can actually go ahead and use false, or you can go ahead and use a null for now. Again, totally your choice, no big deal. Now the most important part is here, that how do we actually go ahead and fetch the videos or get the videos? So we're going to call this one as fetch videos. And fetch video is going to use a callback just like this, and we'll be wrapping it up just like that. So there we go. And there we go. Classic syntax 101. It's not going to be dependent on anyone. We want to load it up as soon as just the page load, then only we want to fire this callback. So that's it. Now it's going to be an async request because we want to try catch, and it's an API call. It's good to have this way. We'll be having a try catch just like this. First, let's worry about the try part. In this, we want to make a request. So await Axios. Oh, suggestions are nice. Axios dot, I am sure that was a get request. Let me just verify that one more time. API and videos route, and this is a get request, simple get request, nothing much. And we'll be saying Axios dot get and API slash videos. So this is what we are doing. Let's go ahead and store that into a response. We can chain it up as well, but then await doesn't really come into the picture. Anyways, I prefer await. And after that, we'll be verifying it first, whether the things are coming up in the array format or not. So we'll be using array method, and it has isArray to check whether the response that's coming up is that or not. And we have to go through with the response data, just like that. Don't go for the response data. Once we are here, we are going to go ahead and use the setVideos method, which is simple, a method to fill up the videos. We'll be saying response.data setVideos. And why are you complaining? Let's just go ahead and see. Why are you complaining? Argument of type any is not assignable. So we probably need to set up a types for it as well. Not that I want to do it, but let's just go ahead and set it up. So let's close this app. And Prisma also, let's create a new folder. And since we might have more types in the future, let's keep it up here. And inside the types, let's create a new file. We can call it as index or videos.ts. And inside here, we're gonna go ahead and export an interface that will be called as video. And this will have a few property like ID as a string. Then we'll be having a title string, original size, number. We have a description as well. Description as a string, we have a public ID. How can we forget that? Public ID, which is of a type string. We have original size, we have compressed size, we have a duration as well. That is number, and created updated. If I'm forgetting anything, you just go ahead and add that. Let's go back up here. Now I think we can just go ahead and import this, that, hey, this is the one that we are working on. So now I can just go ahead and say import video, and that will come up as a type. Now I can actually go ahead and mention this video that this is going to be not an ordinary state. This is going to be like this, and a video, and this is going to be an array of it, and then it should just go away. Again, extra effort just to make sure that we know what we are doing. Again, the else part is error. I think we should throw up a notification system in this one here as well. But I'm going to go ahead and just simply say, first of all, let's just do a console log. Oops. Console log, and we'll say error. Then we will set up the error, set note, set error, just like that. Okay. And this is the error. So this is going to create, why are you having an issue now? Okay, give me the error. And this is how usually the real world problem happens and how it works. Argument of type unknown is not assignable to parameters, set action null. So this is also not assignable. Let's make it assignable. So this is my error. It needs a data type. So let's just say either you'll be storing a string or you'll be storing a null. That should do the job. And let's see, the error unknown. I am sure that I know the type of the error. So let's go ahead and what is your problem? I think we should do a error.message, or at least send a set up a message. So error.message, that should be, but it doesn't run that. So I'll use a hack. And we'll say failed to fetch videos. Apart from this, we have checked this if part, haven't checked the else part of it. So we'll just say that, hey, in the else condition, if this is not the stuff, then go ahead and throw new error. That simply go ahead and say unexpected response format. So at least we know that we have thrown the error because of the format issues. And finally, what we're going to do is, if you remember, and we haven't done this actually, we should have done that. We know that as soon as we start, this loading is true. So we probably can use a finally here. Finally, there we go. And in the finally, we can go ahead and use a set loading, and we can call it as false. Come on, suggestions, there we go. All right, so this is the heavy duty chunk that we need. And now we need one more thing, that when to re-render the page. And for that, we'll be using this exact fetch method videos. And whenever there's a change in fetching of the videos, you go ahead and change that. So let's go ahead and use effect just like that. Run the fetch method methods. And if there is any change in this fetch, rerun it based on this method. So that's a dependency of our entire thing. I think good enough, and should be all good now. Now, I think rest of the stuff is all good. Now, what we'll be doing is, since we are on the home page, I would love to add another handle download. And if you remember in the social share, we actually worked on the handle download. So this is the part of the handle download. We can go ahead and copy this entirely and can create a method on this home page as well, so that people can go ahead and download the videos as well. So in the handle download, this time we don't need the image reference. We'll be saying that you will be passing me a URL, and based on this, I'll be doing this. So this part is not required. We'll be directly passing this stuff. And not only that, we should actually wrap this up entirely in a callback as well. So let's just go ahead and cut this out. Cut this out, and handle download will be handled by use callback. And there we go. We need URL and title. So just like that. And we'll be going like that and further. And we need also one dependency array, which will be nothing. And once we are inside of this, let's go ahead and paste this thing and then try to figure out what we need. So we'll be having URL, we'll be having a title. We don't need to do all of this. Response blob, then I don't think so that's required. In fact, we can just remove all this then part. We can just directly have this windows and links. So let's remove this part, and we don't need this part. Oh, we need that. All right, come on. Cursor is hanging. All right, so this is the part. What we need is just a link. So let's just go ahead and create a simple link or a URL. This is, oh, we can remove this part. Again, this is how the real world it happens. You have to go through with the code, dig up. It doesn't flow as smoothly as people walk you through with the tutorials. No, it's all how you do it. Let me go ahead and fix this one. All right, so finally, after staring at it a little bit, going through with it, this is what we want to do. We want to create a link, which will be creating a document element, create element of A type, and then call it as URL. That's what we are creating. Create an attribute of download, and we'll be clicking on it, and then finally removing it so that we can pop up a window, and nice window should be there. Although I thought I'll be giving you as an assignment for this one, but hey, this is okay. Now, finally, just one last thing before we copy paste our UI part. Is if the state is in the loading state, we don't want to show anything. So we're gonna go ahead and say return div loading. You can add better ones, but I'll be just doing this much only. Now let me go ahead and bring up the UI part of it. All right, so written some CSS, not much, but hey, this is what we have. And all we want to do is once we are having in this grid, which is large, basic a simple grid, and we want to just loop through the video. So we have the videos, we just have to loop through it. I don't think so anything can be much more easier than this. So let's go up here and we can just go ahead and say videos.map, and you can map out on each of it. Each video can be called as video, just video. And we can just fire up like this. Don't use the curly braces, otherwise you have to explicitly return. Otherwise, my recommendation always is go like this so that you can just, you don't have to do anything. And why there is an issue? Because we haven't written anything. So in this, we are gonna just load the video card just like this. And we have all the properties being mentioned. So key, obviously the public ID can actually handle as a key, or we can just use the ID as well. That should also work. In the video, we are passing the video, handle download is being passed on. So that is it. And now what we should be able to see is this. We have one video. I actually uploaded one video, and we can see from 22 MB, it's 1.7 MB. And if I hover over it, this works and this plays. So YouTube SaaS, build a SaaS with the Cloudinary AI. And as you will have more videos, you can just have it, work it. This is not just it. You can take this SaaS really to next level. Now imagine so many people would be excited and would love to pay you if you can provide an affordable solution that, hey, upload your video, we'll compress your video, we'll have a preview of it. You can build it into an LMS, or you can build it one more APIs that where you can send the videos and you can email them there. SRT files, the subtitles, or you can just burn the subtitle here as well. Not only that, you can actually do so much more in the Cloudinary stuff. So let me just go ahead and open up the, where is the Cloudinary? All right, need to find, here it is, too many tabs. So this is just a brief glimpse of what you can possibly do. If you just go ahead and look for it, not just the optimization, there's a transformation, maybe you can intelligently, based on the subtitles, you can figure out which is the most important part of it and can crop the reels out of it. It's super easy to do. Another business idea that you can do. Actually, we use one such for our content as well. And you can do adaptive bitstreaming, text lays. The possibilities are just endless. You need to figure out what all is there. And yes, there is so much requirement. Not everybody is as tech savvy as you think they are. They are not. And that is why in the market, the SaaS product works, because not everybody can build their software. And what you'll find yourself that after 6 months or 1 year, the software is so much expandable that people would say, hey, paying is much more easier than building this on my own, or having a solution is always a good idea. So I highly recommend you to try this out. Maybe add more payment gateways on it that, hey, allows 3 videos for free and then it's chargeable. Add payment gateways, Stripe, Razorpay, whatever you want. I think this video has added enough value to you so that you can leave at least one comment that, hey, thanks. And if you are watching till this long, I think one photo on Twitter, that's all what we ask. And a big shout out to Cloudinary that, hey, they are bringing up such AI solutions that we are able to build so many things onto it. And it was a fun project before my travel begins. This was a very fun project. I enjoyed thoroughly not just building it, but having a discussion with you. That's it. Recommend this video to other people as well. And let's go ahead and catch up in next video.